Well, hello, everybody. My name is Jason DeCosta, and welcome to my show. I thank you for joining me today. Today, we're going to be talking about a very interesting portion in the Old Testament, which comes from Isaiah chapter 9. And you all know it, I'm sure. It doesn't have to even be mentioned, but we'll call it, "Of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end." Now, obviously, as I've been teaching these things and sharing my views, I've gotten some pushback from some of the more traditionalists and in the preterist community. Lots of confusion on this passage, of course. It's one of those that is constantly used by wannabe preterist Israelites. And basically what they do is they place this portion in Isaiah 9 in our day today. They say, look, it says a child is born, so that has to be Christ. They say that the government was going to be on his shoulder, so that has to be Christ. They say that the peace that he brings, he is the Prince of Peace, that has to be Christ. And they say that, look, it says there will be no end of it. That has to be an everlasting kingdom that we're in today, a spiritual kingdom that we're in today. Now, for those of you who have been following me for a while, know that my previous exchange opponent, Mr. William Bell, went to this portion repeatedly, okay, and many do. It's the go-to Old Testament text where all opponents of IO go to try to refute the view. All right, they say, look, Isaiah 9 clearly says that of his increase in government there will be no end. So clearly that means that it is going on today and it is never ending and so on and so forth. And of course they couple this with passages like Ephesians 3:21 and Revelation 21 or 22, I think, where the gates are always open and where the gates remain open because there's no night there. So there's just a lot of confusion. And if you want clarity on the gates and all that, please go to my YouTube channel. And while you're already here, actually, please check out my audio on the gates, all right, where I explain that in its proper context of safety, okay? But we won't get into that too much because we got a lot of things to talk about here. So anyways, it's sort of the go-to place, and it comes up all the time, all right? And people are constantly saying, oh, that refutes your view single-handedly. Well, really, it doesn't, okay? And as I've been studying these things and coming to clarity in the Old Testament more and more every day, I could see that Isaiah 9 was sort of becoming clearer and clearer and clearer to me as these last couple months have gone by. And basically, it's sort of like chiseling, really. You kind of chisel away at other portions in the Old Testament until they shed more light on a difficult portion, such as Isaiah 9. And finally, I think I've got this worked out to the point where I'm very comfortable with sharing an audio about where what I think Isaiah 9 is actually saying. Okay, so now, if you haven't been following me or listening to my audios and you just happen to stumble upon me today, then you've missed me explaining and expounding repeatedly on how most of these Old Testament portions are all about the return to Zion, Second Temple period, when God brought the children of Israel back to the land of Jerusalem, re-inhabited the buildings and rebuilt the cities and the desolate places, rebuilt his temple and so on and so forth. I've been expounding on how many of the most famous Old Testament portions, such as Ezekiel in 36 and 37, where we hear about the two sticks and the dry bones, such as Jeremiah 31, where we hear about the new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah, such as Isaiah 65 and 66, where we read about this new heaven and new earth, where people would literally again dwell and celebrate and be blessed in the land of Jerusalem. and many other places as well in the Old Testament. But my point here is, if you have not been following me and you have no foundation, this is not the proper audio for you to be listening to first, because you will be lost like William Bell. All right, what I would ask that you please do is at least listen to two previous audios before you listen to this one. The two that I would suggest you listen to are, the first one's titled, quote, "I will write my laws on their hearts," end quote. Okay, that was shared maybe a couple weeks back. And the second one is one that I just shared yesterday called Genesis Creation According to Jeremiah and Ezekiel. So if you listen to these two audios, that should give you a firm enough foundation to understand where I'm approaching this from, okay? Now, for those who have been following me, you know very clearly that the prophets of old spoke of this glorious return in numerous different ways, using numerous different words, phrases, and symbols all throughout the Old Testament. All right, as I showed yesterday in Ezekiel 12, God promised through Ezekiel that from that time forward, he would never again postpone his prophecies. Okay, and he would, everything that he said would come to pass, and he would not push it out for many days in the future. That is said in the end of Ezekiel 12, okay, which means that clearly these prophecies of old had to have some sort of nearness to them, some sort of relevance. And as I've been saying, of course they do. When you look at the contextual evidence, it is overwhelming. It all pertains to the return to Zion, where they would literally again dwell in Jerusalem and literally again walk in his law, okay, walk in his laws. And that literally took place. Okay, God set up a banner for the nations. He assembled the outcasts of Israel and the dispersed of Judah. There's the two houses, the house of Israel and the house of Judah. And he brought them back to the land. And he wrote his laws upon their hearts. Now, one thing that I did find interesting that I made a meme about yesterday was the "hope deferred makes a heart sick" Proverbs 13 passage. Now, many full preterists like to use this against futurists. They say, well, see, hope deferred makes a heart sick. So clearly what Jesus said in the first century cannot be pushed out 2,000 years, because that's a long period of time, and that makes the heart sick, according to God himself in Proverbs 13. So clearly, if God is making a promise of hope, and he's giving literal people like the first century saints a promise of hope and blessing, then clearly they came to see that hope and blessing. And it wasn't something that was pushed out for 2,000 years. Okay, and that's the argument, and it's a very valid argument. But they don't carry that same concept back to the Old Testament. Okay, because what we see in the Old Testament is we see these promises from these prophets prophesying to literal people that were in Babylonian exile. Okay, and they're like Ezekiel, he's prophesying to them, like Jeremiah as well. And they're telling these people that they are about to come back to the land of Israel, that God's about to make a new covenant with the two houses, that God's about to forgive them of their iniquity, bring them back, bless them, write his laws on their hearts, give them a new heart, give them a heart of flesh, put his spirit within them. They would be his people and he would be their God. Now, these are all promises to them. But yet guys like Billy Bell and Don Preston and the rest of the gang would say that these promises did not come to pass until roughly AD 70, when this imaginary new kingdom began, spiritual new kingdom that they think they're in. So we have a period of some 600, 650 years from when the prophecies were actually given to the real people back then that were in exile. According to Bell and Preston and others, we have 650 years or so that those promises did not come to pass. So clearly nobody who received those prophecies and promises and that hope received it. Nobody saw it. So was their heart sick? That seems to me like 650 years is clearly hope deferred. So of course they don't apply the same concept in the Old Testament, because if they did, they would understand that these prophecies given by Ezekiel, Jeremiah, Isaiah, that all pertain to the return to Zion in the Second Temple period, literally came to pass in the generation that they were spoken to, give or take 40, 50, 60 years, whatever it was. Okay, so again, just inconsistencies abound here. But back to the point. So those who have been following me know that these prophets use different terms, different words, different phrases, different symbols to all speak of the same thing. For instance, in Jeremiah 31, Jeremiah speaks of this return to Zion as a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah, where God would write his laws upon their hearts. in Isaiah 65 and 66, Isaiah speaks of this return to Zion as a new heaven, new earth, where they would dwell in Jerusalem again, and there would be Levites, priests, new moons, Sabbaths, etc. In Ezekiel 36 and 37, Ezekiel speaks of the return to Zion and says that God would join the two sticks together, Ephraim and Judah, that's the northern and southern kingdoms, the house of Israel and the house of Judah, and he would raise the dry bones and give them life and breathe life into them and so on and so forth. So you can see that these portions that we look at in the Old Testament, they all use different symbols, different words, different ways of describing the same event, that being the return to Zion. But all throughout these portions in the Old Testament, we can look for and easily find what I call key common elements, okay? Key common elements. These key common elements help us to navigate through the different prophetic accounts and keep our imaginations in check. All right, now some may just call this context and focusing on the context, and that would work too. It's really context. You want to focus on the context, the details, and the contextual evidence within the chapters, and let that steer your imagination and understanding as to what's actually being said. All right, but when we have an imaginary spiritual kingdom in mind and we think that this is what it's talking about, we tend to look at literal statements like Isaiah 66 speaking of Levites and priests and new moons and Sabbaths in the coming new heaven and new earth, and we just sort of push that aside and say, ah, that's spiritual, that doesn't really mean what it means. But clearly this is a huge error, and I've come to see it. It's illuminated up for me in recent months. So we look for these key common elements in these Old Testament portions, okay? And sometimes we see one of these elements, sometimes we see two, sometimes we see three or four, sometimes we see a dozen, okay? And they're peppered all throughout these prophecies, all right? And so I'm going to give you some examples of these key common elements that we should look for when we're looking at these Old Testament prophetic texts. Okay, I think I got about 10 listed here, and I want you to really pay attention to them and try to remember them as best as you can, okay? One, God would gather the children of Israel from all the nations where he drove them. Two, God would bring the children of Israel back to the land of Israel, which was promised to their fathers. Three, God would cleanse the children of Israel from all their iniquity and forgive their iniquity and not remember it. The former things wouldn't come to mind. Four, God would remove their hearts of stone and replace them with hearts of flesh. 5. God would put a new spirit within the children of Israel. 6. God would bless the land of Israel and increase the trees with fruit, the land with grain, and give it plenty of abundance. 7. God would multiply men and the people of Israel on the literal land of Israel again. 8. God would cause the children of Israel to again walk in his laws and keep his judgments. And 9, God would be their God and they would be his people. All right, so we have 9 key common elements there that we have to keep in mind. Okay, I'll really quickly repeat them. God would gather them from nations. He would bring them back to the land. He would cleanse them of their iniquity. He would remove their heart of stone and give them a heart of flesh. He would put his spirit within them. He would bless the literal land and make the fruit abound and grain in abundance. He would multiply the people of Israel on the land of Israel. He would cause them to again walk in his laws and judgments, and he would be their God and they would be his people. All right, so we have these key common elements in all of these Old Testament portions. Some portions have one or two, some have three or four, and some have all of them. But if we are alert and aware of how the prophets spoke of the return to Zion using these key common elements, then we won't be fooled when the prophetic portions get a little tricky. All right, we look for these context clues to help us. All right, and that's what we need to get better at, because we really don't understand what we're doing in the Old Testament. So the first place I want to just read through is Jeremiah 50, and I want to show you exactly what this portion talks about, because really all of these portions are all about the same period, but some of them are so very clear, and it just really outlines it beautifully, and Jeremiah 50 is one of those places. So Jeremiah 50, I'm going to read the whole chapter, or just about all of it. I may skip some portions, but verse 1 says this: "The word that the Lord spoke against Babylon and against the land of the Chaldeans by Jeremiah the prophet." So right away we see Jeremiah is speaking against the Chaldeans, the Babylonians, who took the Jews into captivity. All right, he says, "Declare among the nations, proclaim and set up a standard. Proclaim, do not conceal it. Say, Babylon is taken, Bel is shamed. Merodach is broken in pieces, her idols are humiliated, her images are broken in pieces. For out of the north a nation comes up against her, which shall make her land desolate, and no one shall dwell therein. They shall move, they shall depart, both man and beast. In those days and in that time, says the Lord, the children of Israel shall come, they and the children of Judah together." So there's both houses, the house of Israel and the house of Judah. "With continual weeping they shall come and seek the Lord their God. They shall ask the way to Zion," that's Jerusalem, "with their faces towards it, saying, come and let us join ourselves to the Lord in a perpetual covenant that will not be forgotten." All right, so now let's stop there for a second. The word perpetual literally means never ending. Okay, it means everlasting. All right, and it says in a perpetual covenant that will not be forgotten. So now let me ask you a question. We start off with Jeremiah speaking these words to the Chaldeans, all right, those in Babylon who have taken the children of Israel captive. All right, he's speaking these words, and he's declaring that they are going to be left desolate, that a nation from the north is going to come up against Babylon and make her land desolate. All right, and it says, in those days when that happens, the children of Israel will come. They and the children of Judah together will come, asking the way to Jerusalem, with their faces towards it, saying, come and let us join ourselves to the Lord in a perpetual covenant that will not be forgotten. In other words, in a never-ending covenant that will not be forgotten. So, Mr. Full Preterist out there, let me ask you a question, okay? Considering that there is no argument that this is speaking of the return from Babylonian captivity, okay? No argument whatsoever. You cannot argue it. Then why does Jeremiah use the words a perpetual covenant? In other words, a never-ending covenant. Clearly, it is not literal, okay? Because if it was, then AD 70 would not have happened, because that covenant, that second temple that was rebuilt, that law that was put back on their hearts when they walked in it again, when they came back to Zion, ended in AD 70 every jot and tittle. So then what do we do with words like perpetual and never-ending and forever and everlasting? Well, we take them in a sort of hyperbolic sense. In other words, when Abraham was told that he would have a covenant of circumcision of the flesh, it was called an everlasting covenant. Of course, that's over. In Jeremiah 32, when God is again speaking of the covenant that he would make with them when he took them out of Babylon, it is called an everlasting covenant that he would make with them. And of course, we know that that's over. So what we have to do when we come to these places that seem like it's speaking of something that's going to forever take place, we need to understand it in its proper context. It simply means a long time, okay? And perhaps in the moment, God was planning to have a forever covenant and a perpetual never-ending covenant with them, but later on their wickedness and their transgressions came up against them, and God judged them again, and that covenant ended. Clearly we know that Israel was repeatedly breaking the covenant, so that very well could be what happened here. Okay, God is declaring and promising that he would join them back in a perpetual never-ending covenant that would not be forgotten. All right, but then as we come 600 years later to the last days of Israel, we see that that covenant and everything that the wickedness and the evil and everything that had built up, like Jesus said, they were filling up the measure of their father's guilt. In other words, that it was coming to an end. So we just need to understand this in its proper context and not be so strict literal with everything. Otherwise, we'll never, ever, ever come to clarity here. Okay? Verse 6, it says, my people have been lost sheep. Their shepherds have led them astray. Now remember that. I want you to remember that for later in the teaching when we look here and it says, my people Israel have been lost sheep, and their shepherds, key word, their shepherds have led them astray. All right, it says, they have turned them away on the mountains. They have gone from mountain to hill. They have forgotten their resting place. All who found them have devoured them. And their adversaries said, we have not offended because they have sinned against the Lord, the habitation of justice, the Lord, the hope of their fathers. Move from the midst of Babylon, go out from the land of the Chaldeans, and be like the rams before the flocks. For behold, I will raise and cause to come up against Babylon an assembly of great nations from the north country, and they shall array themselves against her. From there she shall be captured. Their arrows shall be like those of an expert warrior. None shall return in vain, and Chaldea shall become plunder. All who plunder her shall be satisfied. Because you were glad, because you rejoiced, you destroyers of my heritage Israel, because you have grown fat like a heifer threshing grain, and you bellow like bulls, your mother shall be deeply ashamed. She who bore you shall be ashamed. Behold, the least of the nations shall be a wilderness, a dry land and a desert, because of the wrath of the Lord. She shall not be inhabited, but she shall be wholly desolate. Everyone who goes by Babylon shall be horrified and hiss at all of her plagues. Put yourselves in array against Babylon all around, all you who bend the bow. Shoot at her, spare no arrows, for she has sinned against the Lord. Shout against her all around, she has given her hand. Her foundations have fallen, her walls are thrown down, for it is the vengeance of the Lord. Take vengeance on her as she has done, so do to her. Cut off the sower from Babylon, and him who handles the sickle at harvest time. For fear of the oppressing sword, everyone shall turn to his own people, and everyone shall flee to his own land. Israel is like scattered sheep. The lions have driven him away. First the king of Assyria devoured him. Now, at last, this Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, has broken his bones. All right, so again, we see the two houses there. First, the king of Assyria has devoured the northern kingdom of Israel. And he says, now, at last, this Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, has broken his bones. So we see both houses judged there. He says, therefore, thus says the Lord God of hosts, the God of Israel, behold, I will punish the king of Babylon and his land as I have punished the king of Assyria. But I will bring back Israel to his home, and he shall feed on Carmel and Bashan. His soul shall be satisfied on Mount Ephraim and Gilead. In those days and in that time, says the Lord, the iniquity of Israel shall be sought, but there shall be none, and the sins of Judah, but they shall not be found. For I will pardon those whom I preserve. So we can see God is forgiving Israel's sins and forgiving Judah's sins and bringing them back. He's pardoning them. He's not remembering the former things, like Isaiah 65 calls it. In verse 21, go up against the land of Merithim, against it, and against the inhabitants of Pekod, waste and utterly destroy them, and do according to all that I have commanded you. A sound of battle is in the land and of great destruction. How the hammer of the whole earth has been cut apart and broken. How Babylon has become a desolation among the nations. I have laid a snare for you. You have indeed been trapped, O Babylon, and you were not aware. You have been found and also caught, because you have contended against the Lord. This is basically all the same. For this is the work of the Lord in the land of the Chaldeans. Come up against her from the farthest border and destroy her utterly. See, the voice of the Lord, the voice of those who flee and escape from the land of Babylon declares in Zion the vengeance of the Lord our God, the vengeance of his temple. Because again, they plundered it. Call together the archers of against Babylon, all you who bend the bow, and camp against all around it. For she has been proud against the Lord, against the Holy One of Israel. Therefore her young men shall fall in the streets, and all of her men of war shall be cut off in that day. I will kindle a fire in his cities, and it will devour all around him. The children of Israel were oppressed, along with the children of Judah. All who took them captive have held them fast. They have refused to let them go. Their Redeemer is strong. The Lord of hosts is his name. He will thoroughly plead their case, that he may give rest to the land and disquiet the inhabitants of Babylon. A sword is against the Chaldeans, against the inhabitants of Babylon, and against her princes and her wise men. Okay, therefore the wild desert beast shall dwell there with the jackals, and the ostriches shall dwell in it. It shall be inhabited no more forever, nor shall it be dwelt in from generation to generation, as God overthrew Sodom and their neighbors, so no one shall reside there, nor son of man dwell in it. Now, obviously we know Babylon, which many agree is modern-day Iraq, if I'm not mistaken, is obviously re-inhabited today. All right, but look what he promises there. He says, it shall be inhabited no more forever, nor shall it be dwelt in from generation to generation. So again, forever and everlasting and everything in the Bible clearly does not mean exactly what people think it means. It has to be understood in a limited context, okay? It's hyperbole. We use the word forever today just like they did. It means just a long period of time or a great amount of something, okay? In verse 41, it says, behold, a people shall come from the north, a great nation, and their voice shall roar like the sea. They shall ride in on horses, set in array like a man for the battle against you, O daughter of Babylon. The king of Babylon has heard the report about them, and his hands grow feeble. Anguish has taken hold of him, pangs as of a woman in childbirth. All right, and he says, therefore, hear the counsel of the Lord that he has taken against Babylon, and his purposes that he has proposed against the land of the Chaldeans. Surely the least of the flock shall draw them out. Surely he will make their dwelling place desolate with them. At the noise of the taking of Babylon, the earth trembles, and the cry is heard among the nations. All right, so Jeremiah 50 is just incredible. It just outlines everything perfectly for you. Okay, we have the two houses coming back to the land of Israel, God forgiving their sin, God cleansing them, God giving them a new heart, God making them walk in his laws again. All the while, he's judging Babylon, who, by the way, he used to judge Israel in the beginning of the exile. It's kind of weird how that works. God uses a nation to judge Israel, but then when that nation treats them too harshly, he turns around and wipes that nation out because he's jealous for his people. All right, and he blesses those who bless them, and he curses those who curse them. So he's a very jealous God here, and we see this often in the Old Testament. But point is that God is destroying Babylon. Okay, the nations will come up against her, and that was basically Cyrus of Persia. Okay, comes up against Babylon, destroys them, and the children of Israel from both houses, Judah and Israel, return back to Jerusalem. Okay, in this glorious return to Zion period. And this is literally what all the prophets speak of. Now, for those who recall my second response to Billy Bell, okay, in our exchange, I replied to his reference of Isaiah 11. Bell argued that applying Isaiah 11 to the return of to the return to Zion out of Babylonian captivity was false, because Isaiah 11 starts out referencing the birth of Christ, or what Bell thinks is the birth of Christ. Bell argued, just like many do, that the entire context of Isaiah 11 and the light going out to the nations was the age that we are now in. He does this based on his faulty understanding of the branch referred to in the first verses of Isaiah 11. Now let's read Isaiah 11 in full, and then we'll make some notes. Isaiah 11 verse 1 says this, "There shall come forth a rod from the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the Spirit of wisdom and understanding. Excuse me, the Spirit of counsel and might, the Spirit of knowledge and of the fear of the Lord. His delight is in the fear of the Lord, and he shall not judge by the sight of his eyes, nor decide by the hearing of his ears, but with righteousness he shall judge the poor, and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. He shall strike the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips he shall slay the wicked. Righteousness shall be the belt of his loins, and faithfulness the belt of his waist. The wolf also shall dwell with the lamb, the leopard with the goat, the calf and the young lion, and fatling together, and a little child shall lead them. The cow and the bear shall graze, the young one shall lie down together, and the lion shall eat straw with the ox. The nursing child shall play by the cobra's hold, and the weaned child shall put his hand in the viper's den. They shall not hurt nor destroy in all my holy mountain, for the earth shall be full of the knowledge of the Lord as the waters cover the sea. And in that day there shall be a root of Jesse who stands as a banner to the people. For the nations shall seek him, and his resting place shall be glorious. It shall come to pass in that day that the Lord shall set his hand again the second time to recover the remnant of his people who are left, from Assyria and Egypt, from Pathros and Cush, from Elam and Shinar, from Hamath and the islands of the sea. He will set up a banner for the nations, and will assemble the outcasts of Israel, and gather together the dispersed of Judah, from the four corners of the earth. Also, the envy of Ephraim shall depart, and the adversaries of Judah shall be cut off. Ephraim shall not envy Judah, and Judah shall not harass Ephraim. But they shall fly down upon the shoulder of the Philistines towards the west. Together they shall plunder the people of the east. They shall lay their hand on Edom and Moab, and the people of Ammon shall obey them. The Lord will utterly destroy the tongue of the sea of Egypt with his mighty wind. He will shake his fist over the river, and strike it in the seven streams, and make men cross over dry shod. There will be a highway for the remnant of his people who will be left from Assyria, as it was for Israel in the day that he came up from the land of Egypt." Now, we see a lot here, okay, but let's take some quick notes. So clearly Bell and others are confused about this rod coming from this branch coming from the stem of Jesse. We'll get into that in a moment. Okay, but we also see here the wolf will dwell with the lamb, the leopard with the goat, and so on and so forth, which is all Isaiah 65 and 66 imagery of the new heaven, new earth. That same new heaven and new earth that would have Levites, priests, new moons, and Sabbaths. That same new heaven and new earth that would have sinners dying accursed and the elect long enjoying the work of their hands. This is the return to Zion period. Nothing is different. What we're seeing different here is different words used by Isaiah in chapter 11 than he used in chapter 65 and 66. But the context is the same. It's the return to Zion period. All right, he says this, "In that day it shall come to pass that the Lord shall set his hand to recover the remnant of his people who are left." Those are Israelites from Assyria, Egypt, Pathros, Cush, so on and so forth. He says that he will set up a banner for the nations and assemble the outcasts of Israel and gather together the dispersed of Judah from the four corners of the earth. There is that two houses coming back again, the house of Israel and the house of Judah. Then he says, "The envy of Ephraim shall depart, and the adversaries of Judah shall be cut off. Ephraim shall not envy Judah, and Judah shall not harass Ephraim." This is a picture of God joining the two sticks together again. There was enmity between the two houses over the law and over their differences when they split. Obviously, you all know the kingdom split story. So God was going to take that away. It says, "Ephraim shall not envy Judah, and Judah shall not harass Ephraim." There would be peace between them. It was a covenant of peace, of perpetual peace, okay? And of the increase of that peace, there would be no end. But let's continue. He says, "They shall fly down upon the shoulder of the Philistines towards the west. Together they shall plunder the people of the east. They shall lay their hand upon Edom and Moab and upon the people of Ammon. The Lord will utterly destroy the tongue of Egypt," and so on and so forth. So all of these judgments that we're reading about here, those are all pictures of what we see in other places, such as Ezekiel, when God is outlining the judgment of all of these same nations because of their dealings with Israel, with scattered Israel. Go read it. Ezekiel, maybe chapters 30 and forward, or maybe mid-20s and forward, you'll read all about these places, Edom, Moab, Ammon, Egypt, and so on. God literally wiped them away because of their handling and dealings with the scattered Israelites. And that all happened right as he was bringing them back. They were judged, okay? So, and then he says, "There will be a highway for the remnant of his people who will be left from Assyria, as it was for Israel in the day that he came up out of Egypt." So this is all, again, basically the return out of these nations to the land of Israel. God would bring peace, join the two sticks together, make a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that he made when he took them out of Egypt, but he would write his laws on their hearts. He would set up a banner, and that banner was the temple and the glorious period that was taking place in Jerusalem. And that light and that banner would go out to the nations and call the people back. He would assemble the outcasts of the house of Israel and gather together the dispersed of the house of Judah. All right. Now, let's take a look here so we can see that this is all about that period. But who is the branch from the root of Jesse? Well, if you recall in my second response to William Bell, the branch was Zerubbabel, the governor of Judah. Okay, and when he was the governor of Judah, when the children of Israel returned from exile, he led that return. And he is the one who is credited with the rebuilding of the temple in that second temple period. All right, so let's look at a few passages, because you most likely may have not heard my second response to Bell, so we'll review this. So Zerubbabel was indeed called the branch. Okay, in Zechariah 3, verse 8, we read this. Speaking of the coming branch, it says, "Then the angel of the Lord admonished Joshua, saying, 'Thus says the Lord of hosts, if you will walk in my ways and keep my command, then you shall also judge my house, and likewise have charge of my courts. I will give you places to walk among these who stand here. Hear, O Joshua, the high priest, you and your companions who sit before you, for they are a wondrous sign. For behold, I am bringing forth my servant, the branch. For behold, the stone that I have laid before Joshua, upon the stone are seven eyes, says the Lord of hosts, and I will remove the iniquity of that land in one day." Now, keep that in mind. God promises Joshua that he is bringing him his servant. He's going to bring forth his servant called the branch. All right. And then when we go a few chapters later to Zechariah chapter 6, we read this right around verse 9. Let's see. Okay, verse 11, he's speaking to Joshua, "Take the silver and gold, make an elaborate crown, and set it on the head of Joshua, the son of Jehozadak, the high priest. Then speak to him, saying, 'Thus says the Lord of hosts, Behold, this the man who, I'm sorry, let me start over. I botched that. Behold, the man whose name is the branch, from his place he shall branch out, and he shall build the temple of the Lord. Yes, he shall build the temple of the Lord. He shall bear the glory and shall sit and rule on his throne. So he shall be a priest on his throne, and the council of peace shall be between them both. Now, remember, this man whose name is the branch is said here twice that he was going to build the temple of the Lord in this return to Zion. So the branch is going to build the temple of the Lord, and he's going to sit and rule. He's going to be a priest, and he's going to have the council of peace. Remember that, council of peace. Okay. And we're going to look at Jeremiah 23 real quick, around verse 5. It says this, "Behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, that I will raise to David a branch of righteousness. A king shall reign and prosper and execute judgment and righteousness in the earth. In his days, Judah will be saved and Israel will dwell safely." Okay, so again, we see this branch, okay, and he's called a king, and this king would execute judgment and righteousness. And in the days of this coming branch, Judah would be saved and Israel will dwell safely. Well, there it is again, the two houses, the house of Israel and the house of Judah, coming back to the land. All right, now what do we do about this from the root of Jesse? Well, indeed, Zerubbabel was from the root of Jesse. All right, he came from the lineage of Jesus. Look at Matthew 1:12. It says, "And after they were brought to Babylon, Jeconiah begot Shealtiel, and Shealtiel begot Zerubbabel, and Zerubbabel begot Abudai, and Abudai begot Eliakim, and so on and so forth, all the way to Christ." And that comes from David, okay? Jesse was the father of David. So the root of Jesse goes, from the root of Jesse comes David, and then the lineage continues on, and we come to Zerubbabel. I don't know if I'm pronouncing that right, but Zerubbabel, I'll call him, okay? And then same thing in Luke chapter 3. Verse 27, we see it again. It says, "The son of Johannes, the son of Resha, the son of Zerubbabel, the son of Shealtiel, the son of Neri, all the way back to the son of Seth, the son of Adam, the son of God." So indeed, he came from the lineage of David, and again, his name is Zerubbabel. So basically, from the root of Jesse, the branch coming from the root of Jesse works perfectly with Zerubbabel. All right? We know he was the one responsible for rebuilding the temple, right? You remember the passage I just showed you in Zechariah 6:12, which says that the coming branch would build the temple. Well, look what Zechariah 4:9-10 says. It says, verse 8, "Moreover, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, the hands of Zerubbabel have laid the foundation of the temple. His hands shall also finish it. Then you will know that the Lord of hosts has sent me to you, for who has despised the day of small things? For these seven rejoice to see the plumb line in the hand of Zerubbabel." All right, so what is Zerubbabel doing there? He's laying the foundation of the temple. His hands are finishing the temple. He's got the plumb line in his hand. This is all about him building the temple. So if we know that the branch was going to build the temple, according to Zechariah 6, and over here we see that the hands of Zerubbabel laid the foundation and finished the temple, then who do we know that the branch was? Of course, it's Zerubbabel, okay? He's the servant, the chosen one. And then in Haggai, chapter 2, we read that Zerubbabel was going to witness the shaking of heaven and earth and the destruction of all those Gentile kingdoms, which I just mentioned, and which treated God's people harshly. Look at Haggai chapter 2, verse 20. It says, "Again, the word of the Lord came to Haggai on the 24th day of the month, saying, speak to Zerubbabel, governor of Judah, saying, I will shake heaven and earth. I will overthrow the throne of kingdoms. I will destroy the strength of the Gentile kingdoms. I will overthrow the chariots and those who ride in them. The horses and their riders shall come down, every one by the sword of his brother. In that day, says the Lord of hosts, I will take you, Zerubbabel, my servant, the son of Shealtiel, says the Lord, and I will make you like a signet ring, for I have chosen you, says the Lord of hosts." Now, what do we see there again? We see that Zerubbabel was what? The governor of Judah when they came back from Babylon and from the captivities. Well, what do we remember in Isaiah 9? It says that of the increase of his government and peace, there would be no end. But we're going to get to that in a minute. So we see that Zerubbabel was chosen as the servant from God, and that God made him like a signet ring because he has chosen him. All right. So now, when we look back at Isaiah 11, all right, what William Bell and others like to botch, and we can see now who clearly this branch was who was going to rule during this return to Zion, can't we? Let's read Isaiah 11 again. It says, "There shall come forth a rod from the stem of Jesse, and a branch shall grow out of his roots. The spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and fear of the Lord. And his delight is in the fear of the Lord." Now, this obviously is not Christ, because if, you know, most people would say that Christ is the Lord. So this says that this man had wisdom and understanding. He had counsel and might. He had the spirit of knowledge, and he feared the Lord. His delight was in the fear of the Lord. So this was a man, okay? And it says he shall not judge by his eyes, but he would judge with righteousness. He shall judge the poor, and so on and so forth. And then it says, "In that day there shall be a root of Jesse, who shall stand as a banner to the people, for the nations will seek him, and his resting place shall be glorious." That's the calling back to Jerusalem once the root of Jesse, who was Zerubbabel, rebuilt the temple and took his place as governor in this new covenant of perpetual peace. Okay, so Isaiah 11 makes perfect sense in the context of Zerubbabel. And of course, we know this cannot be an AD 70 kingdom, because the end of it shows that God was gathering all the Israelites from all the nations where he had driven them. He was doing away with the enmity between Ephraim and Judah. In other words, he was making a new covenant with the house of Israel and the house of Judah. And then we see that God destroys all these Gentile kingdoms who treated his captives harshly. And that is all throughout the Old Testament. He destroys Edom, Moab, Ammon, Egypt. Just go read it. Okay, none of that happened in AD 70. So the context demands that this is indeed Zerubbabel. All right. But now I want to go back to Isaiah 9 and read Isaiah 9, because this is what this teaching is all about. Okay, and we're going to really hope to pull this all together. Now, Isaiah 9. Well, what's interesting about Isaiah is I've been reading through it, and I read through it all in one shot a couple weeks back. And really, it didn't even change context once. It never swayed, in my opinion anyway, it never swayed from this return to Zion. It seems as though from the very first chapter all the way to chapter 66 that Isaiah is concerned with Israel's wickedness, which got them exiled, and God's forgiving them, which was going to bring them back in this new heaven, new earth, which, by the way, he ends his writings with in chapters 65 and 66 as being sort of like the final hurrah, this new heaven, new earth was going to come and be blessed and be a glorious period. So to me, he never takes his focus off of this in the entire book. And I know some will disagree, but that's just me. But anyways, Isaiah 9, just two chapters prior to what I just showed you in Isaiah 11, which is surely Zerubbabel in the context of the return to Zion, Isaiah 9 is speaking of a government, all right, and a government of a promised son. Now let's read it. Verse 1 says this: "Nevertheless, the gloom will not be upon her who is distressed, as when at first he lightly esteemed the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, and afterwards more heavily oppressed her by the way of the sea beyond the Jordan in Galilee of the nations. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in the land of the shadow of the death, upon them a light has shined. You have multiplied the nation and increased its joy. They rejoice before you, according to the joy of harvest, as men rejoice when they divide the spoil. For you have broken the yoke of his burden and the staff of his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, as in the day of Midian. For every warrior's sandal from the noisy battle and garments rolled in blood will be used for burning and fuel of fire." Now here's the tricky part. It says, "For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder. And his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace there will be no end. Upon the throne of David and over his kingdom, to order it and establish it with justice and judgment from that time forward even forever. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will perform this." All right, so now, I know that's challenging, and you're all thinking, there's no way, there's absolutely no way, but hear me out here, okay? Let's learn a little bit more about this Zerubbabel character, all right? So I'm going to read some things that I pulled from Wikipedia and other historical places on the internet, which outline who he was and what he did and where he came from and what his name means and all sorts of fun stuff. So Zerubbabel was in biblical account a governor of the Persian province of Yehud Medinata, and he was the grandson of Joachim. And Zerubbabel led the first group of Jews, numbering about 42,000, who returned from the Babylonian captivity in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia. Okay, Zerubbabel also laid the foundation of the second temple in Jerusalem soon after that, and is credited with building and finishing it. All right, in all of the accounts in the Hebrew Bible that mention Zerubbabel, he is always associated with the high priest who returned with him, that being Joshua. Together, these two men led the first wave of Jewish returnees from exile and began to rebuild the temple. All right. The region of Judah was a small province that contained land extending 25 kilometers from Jerusalem, and it was independently ruled prior to the Persian rule. Zerubbabel was the governor of the province of Judah, which obviously contained Jerusalem. Okay. King Darius I of Persia appointed Zerubbabel governor of the province of Judah. All right, so he's governor, okay? He's appointed governor of this new time of peace, this new covenant, okay? It says this, if it was after this appointment that Zerubbabel began to rebuild the temple and finished it. All right, now, if we read further, this is the very interesting part here. It's about his name, okay? Now, it says this, if the name Zerubbabel is Hebrew, it could be a contraction of the words Zeruah and Babel, okay, meaning, quote, the one sown of Babylon, and referring to a child conceived and born in Babylon, okay? If the name is not Hebrew, but of Assyrian Babylonian origin, then it very well could mean, or could have the contraction of Zeruah, Babel, meaning seed of Babylon, the one conceived in Babylon. And for those of you who know anything about Hebrew, the Hebrew word Zera, Z-E-R-A, is seed. Okay, so when we look at Zera Babel, it makes sense that this is the seed from Babylon, the one born and conceived in Babylon. Okay, now let's go back to Isaiah 9 for a moment, and let's read the beginning. It says, verse 6, for unto us a child is born, and unto us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulder. All right, so if we go back and we read that again about Zerubbabel's name and where it comes from, if you just stop and look at his name, Zerubbabel, okay, meaning Zeru seed, Babel, Babylon, Zerubbabel, okay, so the seed of Babylon, the one born in Babylon. Okay, so very likely this is what this means, okay, and that takes care of Isaiah 9:6, where the son who was born, who would have the government on his shoulders, remember, Zerubbabel was made governor of the new covenant period when they came back to Judah and Jerusalem. All right, so doesn't it make sense that the government would be upon the shoulders of the governor? It does make sense, but let's read something else here that I found. All right, it says this, Zerubbabel, as his name imports, was born in Babylon and was the leader of the first colony of Jews which returned from the Babylonian captivity around 536 BC. Cyrus committed to his care the sacred vessels of the temple with which he returned to Jerusalem. He is always named first as being chief of the Jews that returned to their own country. He, Zerubbabel, laid the foundations of the temple and finished the temple, and he restored the worship of the Lord and the usual sacrifices. All right, so now Zerubbabel was one who really worshiped the Lord, okay? He basically took this very seriously. He restored the practices, he restored the law, okay? And look what it says here in Isaiah 11, what I just read to you in Isaiah 11 about this branch. It says, the spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. His delight is in the fear of the Lord. He shall not judge by the sight of his eyes, but with righteousness he will judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth. This is Zerubbabel, the governor, the judge, the ruler of the people. Okay, and why was he judging with righteousness? Well, because he feared the Lord. All right, and that's what we read in Isaiah chapter 9. Okay, we read that unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. And his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and Prince of Peace. Now, I know what you're saying there. Look, it says that this is God. It's saying this, that, and the other. It's got to be God. It's got to be the new covenant. It's got to be Christ. Well, not so fast. Remember what I read to you in Haggai, how God called Zerubbabel, chosen as a signet ring. Okay, I'll read it to you again. He says, in that day, says the Lord of hosts, I will take you, Zerubbabel, my servant, the son of Shealtiel, says the Lord, and I will make you like a signet ring, for I have chosen you, says the Lord. Well, for those of you who don't know what a signet ring is, let me help you out. Okay, I'm going to read something to you. Okay, so the quotation from the book of Haggai illustrates the expectations that are associated with Zerubbabel. The term my servant describes Zerubbabel as God's servant. Okay, this term is often associated with King David as well. All right, the term servant is hardly ever used for kings after David, but may be related to the fact that most of them were disappointing in their performance as kings appointed by Yahweh. All right, so basically the book of Haggai is associating Zerubbabel with King David. All right, now, The most widely debated part of this prophecy is the phrase, "Wear you like a signet ring." Now, a signet ring is an authoritative symbol that is associated with power. All right, it's this when comparing this passage to the passage in Jeremiah 22:24, where we see the king is a signet ring on God's hand. So, basically, it's the idea of the nature of the signet ring is such that the real, true figure of speech is a personification of God. In other words, the one who is the signet ring is actually the personification of the one who is the signet ring is the personification of the one who's wearing the signet ring. So in this case, the one who is the signet ring is Zerubbabel, and he's the personification of the one who wears the signet ring. And so in Haggai, he says, I will take you, Zerubbabel, says the Lord, and make you like a signet ring, for I have chosen you. All right, so in other words, God is taking Zerubbabel like a signet ring. He's wearing Zerubbabel as a signet ring. And when a signet ring is basically, let me see if I can get the right definition of this for you. All right, bear with me one moment. Sorry, I had this pulled up here. But basically, the signet ring is basically a sign or a signal that this person had the authority of the one higher. In other words, a king would give a person a signet ring, and that signet ring would be worn by that person, and that person would be basically taken by the people as the authoritative word of the king. Okay, so when Zerubbabel was being designated as a signet ring of God, he was basically being taken as the very word of God, the very voice of God, the very representative of God on earth. All right, let's see if I can kind of draw this out a little bit with something that I found here. A signet ring was used to seal a stone. A royal signet ring is also featured in Esther 8:8. It's important to understand who Zerubbabel is. He is the governor of the rebuilt Jerusalem, and is himself of royal blood, being a descendant of David. Now God calls Zerubbabel the signet ring, and God is giving Zerubbabel encouragement and hope. The governor is chosen for a unique and noble purpose. As God's signet ring, Zerubbabel is given a place of honor and authority. God is reinstating the Davidic line and renewing his covenant. So basically, what I'm trying to get at here is that this signet ring sort of motif and this idea is basically God giving Zerubbabel his image. In other words, Zerubbabel would wear that signet ring, and Zerubbabel would be the very authority of God, the very authority of the Prince of Peace, the very authority of the wonderful Counselor, okay, the very authority of the Everlasting Father. All right, now, that to me is a perfect understanding of this, because the signet ring means just that. It means that he was one who could come in the authority of the one who gave him the ring, in other words, the king. But there is something interesting to note about that passage when we look at it in the Young's literal translation. So when we look at that passage, it says this. It says this: "For a child has been born to us, a son has been given to us, and the princely power is on his shoulders. And he doth call his name Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Father of Eternity, and Prince of Peace." So in the Young's literal translation, we see that this is actually translated a little different. It says, "For a child has been born to us, a son has been given to us, the princely power is on his shoulder, and he does call his name Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Father of Eternity, Prince of Peace." So in other words, it's saying he does call his name. In other words, who's calling who? It seems to me that this child, this governor, Zerubbabel, does call his name Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Father of Eternity. In other words, it says everything else that we've been seeing, that Zerubbabel feared the Lord. Okay, he had fear of the Lord. He was the Spirit of the Lord dwelled upon him. He ruled righteously because he feared God. And what does he say here? It says, and he does call his name Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Father of Eternity, Prince of Peace. So I just found that translation interesting there, but I'm sure that it's one or the other, okay? Or it could be a little bit of both. It could be, like I said earlier, that the signet ring is what answers this whole question, that the governor who had this rule on his shoulder, the one born from Zerubbabel, meaning seed of Babylon, and obviously we know Zerubbabel was born in Babylon during the Babylonian captivity, and he led his people back to Jerusalem. So that works perfectly. But I think the signet ring, having the very image of God and being the very representative of God, works just perfect here, okay? And of course, that Young's literal translation that I just showed you is pretty interesting as well. So I think that's pretty interesting to note. And obviously, I've showed you where two chapters later, where Isaiah is talking again of this branch, this same rod of Jesse, and it's all about Zerubbabel bringing the children back to the land and God judging those Gentile nations during that time, and Ephraim and Judah having peace again because he was joining the two sticks together. So it's safe to say that just two chapters earlier, this would not be any different, okay? The one born was the Zerubbabel, the seed of Babylon, the one born in Babylon, who was Zerubbabel, who would be governor of Jerusalem. The government would be upon his shoulder. He would wear the signet ring of God. He would be the very representative of the everlasting counselor, the mighty God, the Prince of Peace on earth. Okay, and I think that really, really explains it well. And I was going to tie in Ezekiel 34 to it, because Ezekiel 34 basically ties in with that, and I'll just read it really quick. It says, "I will make," in verse 25, after he speaks about Israel and everything, and the scattered sheep and the shepherds who forsook them. In verse 25 of Ezekiel 34, it says, "I will make a covenant of peace with them and cause wild beasts to cease from the land, and they will dwell safely in the wilderness and sleep in the woods. I will make them and the places all around my hill," that's Jerusalem, "a blessing. And I will cause showers to come down in their season. There shall be showers of blessing. Then the trees of the field shall yield their fruit. The earth shall yield her increase. They shall be safe in their land, and they shall know that I am the Lord, when I have broken the bands of their yoke and delivered them from the hand of those who enslave them. And they shall no longer be prey for the nations, nor shall beasts of the land devour them, but they shall dwell safely, and no one shall make them afraid. I will raise up for them a garden of renown, and they shall no longer be consumed with hunger in the land, nor bear the shame of the nations any more. Thus they shall know that I, the Lord their God, am with them, and they, the house of Israel, are my people, says the Lord. You are my flock, the flock of my pasture. You are men, and I am your God, says the Lord God." So what do we see there? And we see some incredible ties back to Isaiah 9. We see the joy in both places. We see in Isaiah 9 that Isaiah speaks of the rejoicing over the harvest. Okay, in Ezekiel 34, we see that the trees would yield fruit and the earth would increase. That's the harvest. We see that in Isaiah 9 that in Isaiah 9 it says, "You have broken the yoke of burden and the rod of his oppressor." All right, that's Isaiah 9. Let me go back and read it for you. Get out of this Young's literal translation here. So in Isaiah 9, it says in verse 4, "For you have broken the yoke of his burden and the staff of his oppressor, the rod and the staff off his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, as in the day of Midian." And then it goes on to say, "For unto us a child is born." But the broken the rod of his oppressor matches what we see in Ezekiel when he says, "I broke the bands of their yoke and delivered them from the hand of those who enslaved them." Same exact context. And then it says here, it says the government will be upon his shoulder in Isaiah 9. And then in Ezekiel 34, it says, "My servant," where is it? Let's see. "My servant shall be a prince among them." Okay, that's the same thing. Remember, Zerubbabel. Sorry about that. I just had to take a phone call, and I'm sure that kind of broke up a little bit there. But as I was saying, we know that Zerubbabel was called a servant and a prince. And we see in Ezekiel 34 that "my servant, a prince, will be among them." And that matches the government being upon his shoulder. And then we see in Isaiah 9, we see that the increase of peace will have no end. And we see again that this covenant of peace says, "I will make a covenant of peace with them," when Ezekiel 34 is speaking of bringing back the children of Israel. And then, of course, we see at the end there that he says, I will raise up for them a garden of renown." In other words, he's pulling back from garden imagery. In other words, the promised land. "And they shall no longer be consumed with hunger, nor bear the shame of the nations. Then they shall know that I, the Lord their God, am with them, and they, the house of Israel, are my people." That's that same thing I told you earlier about God saying he will be their God and they will be their people. It's all the same. It's just worded differently, but the context and the key common elements are all there. So again, just to recap, Isaiah 9, in my opinion, is no different than the rest of the surrounding context. Okay, it's all about Zerubbabel, who was the child who was born, Zerah meaning seed, Babel meaning Babylon, seed of Babylon, and indeed we know Zerubbabel was born in Babylon during the captivity, and he led his people back to the land of Jerusalem, and he was the governor, whose Isaiah says the government will be upon his shoulder. He was the branch, according to the very words of the Bible. He was the servant. He was the branch who built the temple and raised the temple. He was the signet ring of the Lord God, meaning the very image of God on earth. And he was basically and it says that he would be in charge of this new covenant of peace, perpetual peace. Remember, I showed you in Jeremiah 50 that the covenant that was going to be made with them when they were brought back to the literal land of Jerusalem was called a perpetual covenant, meaning a never-ending covenant. But of course, we need to understand that properly, because that covenant indeed came to an end some 600 years later when Jesus said it was coming to an end. All right, so the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end, needs to be understood in light of all the other seemingly never-ending statements that are made, which are just used to represent a long period of time. Okay, and again, like I said, probably a lot of these prophecies were said with the expectation of this covenant being perpetual and having no end. But of course, we know what happened. The wickedness and the evil took its toll, and indeed there was an end. But either way, we have to understand that these things in their proper context, and we have to let the Bible interpret the Bible. And when we do that, we see that everything fits perfectly within the return to Zion context. All right, and as I showed earlier in Ezekiel 12, none of the prophecies were going to be postponed anymore. So these, unto us a child is born, the government's going to be on his shoulder, new covenant with peace, and he will order it and establish it with judgment and justice, and so on and so forth. That's a promise of hope given to literal, real people during this time frame. And of course, we know that hope deferred makes the heart sick. So did they receive that promise, or did people 700 years later receive that promise? I think we know the answer, and everything's right there in front of our face. But anyways, I appreciate you guys listening to this. I hope it made a lot of sense. If you have any questions, do feel free to comment and ask, or reach out to me privately. And so Isaiah 9, not what you think it is. But we will hopefully be back another day with another audio real soon. Take care, everybody. Bye-bye.
direction that I take, and all my choices.